Well, welcome aboard again for another journey into the wonderful world of trains. I'm your host of Chicago Junction. My name is Brian Ballou, and we want to welcome you all for another fun evening of trains, planes, and automobiles. Somehow it gets in there. I'd like to introduce our electrical engineer, Mr. John DeVita.
Well, thank you very much, Brian. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another broadcast of Chicago Junction from the John DeVita Broadcast Center on the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network on Wednesday, April the 13th, the year 2022. Today, the panel will be talking about railroads and model railroads. And to start today's broadcast, here's our announcer, Mr. Brian.
Thank you, John, very much. And we have our panel of know-it-alls.
Where?
And I'm Brian Ballou. I am a rail enthusiast. I model in just about any gauge and a little bit of everything. I enjoy railroad history, and working on the equipment. I'm a member of several museums, the Reading Company Historical and Technical Society of Reading, Pennsylvania. A member of Heston Steam Museum, Pacific Southwest Railway Museum in Campo, California. I belong to a few organizations, the Chicago Chapter, NRHS, Chicagoland Lion Elk Club, Chicago Area Garden Railway Society, and volunteer at the museum, or the Botanic Gardens.
And that's our show for tonight, ladies and gentlemen.
None of us can top that.
And when he runs out of steam, he'll be buried at a hobby shop near you.
And to my right.
Yeah, this is Doug Kenyuk, adjunct professor at Wright College, officer in the Railroad and Short Lines Club of Chicago, a rail fan, long time, and an N-scaler.
Hi, my name is Kevin, and I'm a rivet counter. Hi, I'm Kevin Berry. I'm a retired Chicago police sergeant. Lifetime Lionel owner and operator. Still have my Christmas in 1957 Lionel train that I take out from time to time and run when I'm surrounded by people who have all the brand new Lionel with all the bells and whistles. It's a one-owner train. I'm a director with the Chicagoland Lionel Railroad Club, and I just love trains.
And folks, he passed his, what did you pass today? On the firing range.
I passed my annual qualification for my retired officer concealed carry.
I feel so much safer driving with him now.
But the paper wasn't shooting back.
Well, they know partly why.
It could be arranged.
Yeah. Hey, any day that starts out with coffee and range time is a good day.
True.
Really? Hi, my name is Ron Messner, and I enjoy trains, and I'm a garden railroad. Is that better? Thank you. And I'm starting to work on my railroad as soon as the weather breaks. And I enjoy being here with these crazy know-it-alls. And we just have a good time. Dave?
Hi.
Hi.
Yeah, you look like it.
Yeah, hi. I'm Dave DeRusca. I am a retired locomotive engineer. Last place I worked was Metra. And I am the vice president and program chair of the Black Hawk chapter of the National Railway Historical Society. I am the guy in charge of Chicago Railroad History Month. And I do our Chicago Junction Facebook page. And that's about it.
That's enough.
Yep. Let's get the Menards dude first.
Okay.
We'll let you go first for a change.
Save big money.
When you get your allowance, this is what Menards is offering. They came out with an email dated yesterday for ore cars. You know, standard ore cars. What's really neat about them is they offer four road names. A Union Pacific in the armor yellow with about a scale foot olive green stripe around the top of the... Excuse me. My sinuses are trying to kill me. I think they're going to win. Down the long sides on both sides, it's an olive green stripe. I've never seen that particular paint job before. A black-bodied Pennsylvania ore car. The rust-red Canadian National. And a medium green Burlington Northern. But what's really neat is they offer an 8-car pack with 2 cars from each of the 4 roads. So you don't have to choose whether you want, you know, 8 cars from one road or you just want that. They also came out with new box cars. They've got a Southern Pacific Hydra Cushion. They've got a Santa Fe, Ship and Travel Santa Fe. They've got a white Lehigh Valley with the red flag with the black Lehigh Valley diamond in it. And then a Pennsylvania with the PRR logo at one end and an outline of the state of Pennsylvania with a little dot that says Harrisburg. And it's also offered as a 4-pack. They're trying to clear stock on the Save Money at Menards Car and the Missouri St. Louis. They're marking those out as almost gone. They came out with intermodal cars, TTX cars. And they're telling people that if you want the 14 3/4-inch Alaska flat car with the dump truck, those are almost out of stock. And they've got a new 4-pack of trucks. Now, these are 10.5-inch cars, but they offer a fire truck, a Sunoco tanker, a wrecker, and an REA truck. And they're very, the trucks are, all seem to, the cab style, it's not a true cab over engine, but it's from that era.
Sort of like pickup truck style?
No, not at all. And they came out with a really unique lift bridge at a very reasonable price. They call it an aerial bridge. I think it's $139. It does not lift, but it has all the detail. It has motor buildings, but it is not a functioning lift bridge. You know, it's a set piece. But, I mean, nicely detailed. The 2 motor buildings light up. It comes with 24 panels that you can put in to show who owns the property. There's a bunch of high-speed rail stuff here. I think we'll skip until later. Sarah, C-E-R-A, is this. They are putting programs out on the internet. They have a new venture. It's operating out of Chicago. It's operating out of 899 Plymouth Court. So, the Central Electric Rail Fans Association.
They've been around for a while.
They may be, but they're advertising what they're doing real good. Charles Rowe sent out the notice, and I don't know if there's any currently still available, but there were 203 Amtrak Genesis engines painted, model O-gauge, painted up in an Operation Lifesaver scheme. If you're interested in that, go to the Charles Rowe website. I believe they're $400.
Lionel sent me the email.
Okay. Well, you know, Brian, that's one of the good things that you do out of the goodness of your heart.
Yes, I forgot to mention I was a volunteer for Operation Lifesaver.
I've sat in on a couple of your Operation Lifesaver briefings, and not only do you get the information out, but you work real hard at not putting your audience to sleep while you're doing it. And I got an email from the Cuyahoga Valley Scenic Railway. They are in full swing already and have something going every weekend in April. And the 765 is going to be back at the Cuyahoga Valley Scenic Railroad over the summer. We've got a young man out at the club, and he drives me nuts every time I'm at the club. He's so excited about going on this day trip with the 765. Apparently he did it when it was in the area as the masquerading as the Joliet Rocket. And his father is going to drive him 5.5 hours out to Cuyahoga Valley Scenic Railway so he can make the 765 trip. It's a nice engine. It's a beautiful engine. It's a beautiful piece of history. My wife and children and I rode behind it as a nickel plate doubleheader, the Mikado and the Berkshire, from the old Cal Diamond Yard at 103rd and Stoney out to Argus, Indiana, to the Y. And Pentex was so very kind to take a shot, a full-on shot from the back, making me look like a boxcar. Don't you say a word. I'll crack you with the clipboard.
Moi?
Yeah, moi. But it's a beautiful engine. And it was really neat because they take such good care of it. After they watered it and fueled it, the guy got out with the paintbrush and the pint can of white paint and repainted the white walls on all the drive tires. Yeah. I think I remember that pretty much more than anything else on the trip. And it was a great trip. So, well, there's going to be a ton of excursion trips. A friend of mine from the club, also a police officer, said he got an email from UP that they're going west by north with the big boy, and Uncle Brian will talk more about that later. I'm sorry.
Did he hurt your feelings?
No. I love being stepped on. The way I've been speaking lately, that's okay.
You didn't say you were talking about the big boy.
No, I don't talk about steam locomotives and stuff like that.
I'll let you go through all the details.
No details. You've got it. Go for it.
They got. He mentioned it's going from Cheyenne out to Washington, and I believe he said it's looping back through Montana. He didn't have a whole lot of details to give me. He doesn't know if it's a showcase tour or if there's going to be seats available. If there are, I'm sure Brian has that information. So that's all I got.
No seats.
Okay.
They'll have guests on board that are very influential to the system.
Well, I don't think
it's not going to be open to the public. I don't except think where it's on display.
I don't think I'm going to need to worry about getting an invitation for any of those guest seats.
You know, just make sure you have your shirt ready when it finally comes back to Chicago.
And the hat. Haven't worn the hat or the shirt. Well, I wore the shirt one time. But yeah, it's hanging up with all my train stuff in near pristine condition. Because I know if I get asked to do it, it would be a terrible faux pas to decline.
That's right.
Permission to withdraw, sir.
Okay. Metro News. One of the largest commuter railroads in the country is objecting to the proposed $31 billion merger of Class 1 freight rail carriers Canadian Pacific Railway and Kansas City Southern Railway. Chicago's Metro Railroad, which operates extensively in Chicago, its suburbs, and as far north as southeastern Wisconsin, filed an objection March 15th to the five-member Surface Transportation Board, which has the ultimate authority to approve or disapprove the deal. Metro's lawyers argue the merger would be disruptive and exacerbate, there's a big word, safety issues for its passengers on at least two of its north and westbound passenger lines, totaling 100 miles of track. Ooh. It could also potentially increase delays by 400% because Metro would share track with the added freight service. In the Chicagoland area, Canadian Pacific shares tracks with Metro's Milwaukee District, West and North lines, which begin in downtown Chicago and run passenger trains with more than 45 stops between them. Metro and several suburban communities have raised concerns about the potential increase in freight traffic that a CP-KCS railroad would bring. So, there's a big, long article here about all these objections, but I don't know if it's going to really get them anywhere.
I mean, you mentioned the word passing siding, and open up that can of worms again.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but see, that was filed right after CPKCS announced, well, we've been doing a traffic study, and it looks like we're going to have more trains out of Bensenville, and we'll have more trains out of this spot, and all of a sudden, a whole bunch of people, now you think you saw that on STB, whole bunch of suburbs suddenly formed a coalition to say, oh, no, wait a minute, more trains? No. Surprisingly enough, though, Barrington didn't file an objection.
There were 2 days last week that they had passenger trains delayed because of freight interference. You know, both sides have something for their talking heads known as lawyers to bring before the STB.
We'll see. And if you notice, a lot of the backups are because they don't have crews changed out. See, crews can work for 12 hours and they got to stop. And they really have to stop.
Yeah, they go dead.
Right.
To use the term. Vernacular.
Under certain circumstances, they are required to clear crossings and interlockings. You know, they can work beyond their 12, but...
But when they're on the tracks and they go and there's no...
Yeah, if we're in the middle of nowhere, if they got some crossing out in the middle of nowhere blocked, it could take days for them to get a crew.
Yeah, because, you know, they don't want to bring anybody back to work.
They had one day last week when the Burlington Northern added all the new runs. They scheduled a train, but they forgot to schedule a crew.
This is a commuter service?
Yes.
And Metro is going to be doing that soon. April 25th. They're adding more trains.
What lines?
Northwest Line, I believe the West Line, and North.
Are they going to be adding anything to the Milwaukee Line? Because the Milwaukee service is still running what they had back last year.
Yeah, well, no, they're talking about each line separately.
Oh, okay.
Now, this one deals with the Chicago Northwestern lines. And Yes, they're going to be running up to 66 trains a day.
Wow.
From the, they were running, 52 or something like that? They're going to run it up to 66. No, I take that back. It was 38 trains that they were running.
Well, the first
because more people are going to work and the trains are getting crowded.
The 1st of April, many employers in the loop said, all right, come back to your desks.
Right.
And many employees said, ha, ha, ha.
Yeah.
Well, not coming back.
Well, Metra announced yesterday, this was last week, that its expansion on its UP Northwest line and modifications, the UP North line, effective April 25th. The new weekday schedule for the UP Northwest increased by 21 trains to 66. Total trains will allow better connections to the other UP lines, Metra official said in a press release. And I'm going, oh, this is going to be good. We have since started the COVID-19 pandemic that Metra is committed to scheduling, adjusting its schedules to meet the ridership and the ridership's changing needs. So a lot of people that have been driving to work better prepare for long waits. Said Metra CEO Director Jim Durinsky, we are greatly encouraged by the growth of the ridership so far this year for UP North. Schedules being adjusted to add one morning departure and one evening departure to and from Kenosha. New schedule will divide rush area PIDs into three-zone pattern that will better balance passenger loads and allow the transit agency to improve express service to stations furthest from Chicago.
Granddaughter pictures.
The changes will better accommodate riders who take the train to work for early shifts and the first train arriving downtown Chicago at 5:32 a.m. in the morning. Whenever UP North Line is also experience a slight reduction in midday service due to construction projects, that the work window can be lengthened to a single track areas. And that is all.
Oh.
That's my Metro news for the day.
What is all that dinging going on?
Granddaughter pictures.
Can we...
I'm trying.
Delayed deliveries of new Siemens-built Venture rolling stock for Midwest and California routes have added to a cascading lack of equipment at a time of surging travel demand, a problem felt beyond the areas where new equipment will operate and extending into the long-distance fleet. Cars in the Siemens order for coaches, business class, and cafe cars purchased by the states began arriving in summer of 2020 after numerous delays caused in part by supply chain testing and manufacturing issues. Four coaches finally began carrying travelers on one Chicago St. Louis Lincoln service train set on February 1st. Unfortunately, the magnets that hold the table extensions in place have been removed and brackets are being installed to keep the flaps from extending while less powerful magnets are required. Strong magnetic fields have disrupted electronic devices. Who ordered those magnets? I want to know.
Can you imagine being the poor PhD candidate that's trying to do some work on the train and the table magnet wipes out your thesis?
But the Siemens equipment has since been withdrawn from service after it was learned that magnets in the four-seat worktop tables and the coaches were disrupting operation of passenger smartphones and laptops. Those magnets are used to lock extensions on the tables. Let's see, what else? The tables. Still to come are the Venture Cafes, which had always been planned as the final Midwest cars built. Deployment setback is only the latest blow in an equipment shortage that has reverberated through the Amtrak network. And they go on to, in this article, explain the domino effect and yada, yada, yada. Demand for the Horizon cars, which are the older ones, remain. They were supposed to become surplus. Now they're not going to be surplus anymore. So Amtrak has its share of problems with their new equipment. Surprise, surprise. As well as with the with their new high-speed rail equipment. You can find that article.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. And Siemens is doing a song and dance and explaining, well, you know, we got all these problems. Just can't seem to get it solved.
Does anybody know if any cars have rolled out of that new, well, it's several years old now, train assembly building at 136th and Torrance?
Oh, the one for the CTA cars? I don't know. Yeah, that was a Chinese venture. Huh. Testing of Amtrak's next generation of solid train sets on the Northeast Corridor has shown that further modifications will be necessary, pushing back the date the equipment will be placed in service because additional testing will be necessary. So now what the testing has found that additional testing is necessary. Amtrak revealed last week at a Philadelphia media event that the first of the 28 9-unit train sets being built by Alstom are not expected to enter service until sometime in 2023. The debut originally expected in 2021 had been pushed back last year. Amtrak says further computer modeling and simulation tests are required, explaining in the statement. These are the first train sets built under FRA's Tier 3 rule, which set new design specifications to allow for operations at higher speeds and on shared corridors. We hope this will be the first of many trains built under this new framework and that the lessons learned here will benefit those efforts. The train sets are 25% lighter than the current Acelas, which were built to earlier standards that required vehicles to not suffer structural degradation in a crash. The Tier 3 standards allow crush zones to absorb impacts as long as the passenger compartment is designed to keep occupants safe. This is a standard used by European, Japanese, and Chinese train set manufacturers to attain higher speeds when operated on dedicated right-of-way with tight track variance variation tellerships, which we know don't exist in this country.
What do you mean you want wheels on those things?
Yeah, right. When the first new Highliner showed up in the electric district, they had the Japanese technicians riding them. They couldn't believe how bad the track was. You know, this is American, the high standards. So Amtrak's got its issues.
Oh, yeah.
So I'll take a break here and let somebody else talk for a while.
Yep. All right. Just got a couple items. Mm-hmm. Not much. Quiet time. In Seattle, in Sound Transit, a group called Skylink wants to replace the light rail service to West Seattle with a gondola, overhead gondola system. And they claim, well, it could be up and running by 2026 and cost $2 billion less. So they want currently the light rail extension isn't expected to be up and running until 2032. And is already 73% over budget. And they're still mucking around with it. Now, Seattle, I believe, is in King County, Washington. That's because the cement workers have been on strike since the first of the year. There's been no cement mixed, poured, or whatever in this King County, Washington. So King County and the cities involved with all their projects are looking into making their own cement so they can finish the rail projects. However, as of 4/12, a couple of days ago, the Teamsters have unconditionally offered to return to work while negotiations continue. So they still don't have apparently the Teamsters walked out. There's no contract. And they decided to be nice now that every project out there that involves cement is 4 to 6 months behind schedule to go back to work. But they want to make their own cement.
Who's going to deliver it, though?
That's a good question. Now, I'm not sure where this is at. It's in Montana. Libby and Troy, Montana. Apparently, Burlington Northern has a rail yard there. well, had a rail yard. Crews have been cleaning asbestos from the two rail yards in Libby and Troy, Montana, and 42 miles of track. The asbestos is a product of the mining of vermiculite that was processed and transported by rail. We all know what asbestos was used for. Had some moved out of our house. The mine is still being cleaned, and that project is expected to last another 4 years. The mine closed in 1990, and they're still cleaning up the asbestos as of today. And the cleaning has already cost $600 million. BNSF will continue to use the rail line as agreed to manage the impacted area. So it's still filled with asbestos, it's still creating asbestos clouds, and they're still running the trains through it. Right on top of things.
Right, now, just like those Russian soldiers that are digging.
Were digging.
They move them out from Chernobyl?
Permanently. They had a bunch of them died of radiation poisoning.
Oh, so they glowed in the dark a little bit. What's the problem?
Easy to find.
I remember enough of the NBC or CBR, depending on what acronym they were using, training, that radiation poisoning is a very unpleasant and painful way to get your ticket punched off the sphere. You might, eating rat poison would be kinder.
Sorry for the digression.
Montreal's mega light rail project now sits in purgatory after design revisions released. This is a case where the city says, let's go build a rail line, and then they become the number one NIMBY. Says here, the city is still calling the proposed route, which will have 23 stations on 32 kilometers of track, an eyesore, and believes it will be inefficient and will threaten at least two neighborhoods. Due to the continued concerns, Quebec's Environmental Review Agency will delay public hearings. The move means work will not begin until mid-2023. Last week, Prime Contractor unveiled new designs for the project it believed addressed more than 80% concerns of raised in the report authored by the Expert Advisory Committee. The Advisory Committee report was critical of the project's original design, stating that the large concrete pillars to support the elevated track would end up dividing neighborhoods. The report said the elevated track needed to be fundamentally revised and expressed concern about the large gap that it would create where the trains would exit the tunnel onto the elevated track. The changes include 16-kilometer pedestrian promenade, bike paths, and green space. An urban outlook overlooking the route's tunnel entrance on René Roscoe also would be constructed, and the wire system would take the form of a series of arches above the track. The revisions, however, are not included in the final price tag. So let's see. The city says, let's go build a new light rail line. They see the design, and they go, ooh, not my backyard. It makes
sense. And the price goes on.
Yeah, so the price goes up.
They've been watching the Senate hearings too much.
Yeah. Well, here's one that I keep saying is going to happen, and it's one step closer to crewless trains. Seoul Robotics and Herzog develop rail obstacle detection system. South Korean software company Seoul Robotics has launched a critical asset monitoring solution in collaboration with railroad systems and technology integrator Herzog Technologies. The CAM solution is an automated obstacle detection and warning designed to ensure safety for rail passengers, operators, and pedestrians. To decrease future railroad incidents, the system incorporates Seoul's robotic 3D perception software with Herzog's occupancy detection platform, compatible with more than 75 different types and models of 3D sensors. The CAM system can identify humans, vehicles, bicycles, and other foreign objects, being able to assess the situation based on complex positions and behavior of the objects being monitored. Now, I'm not going to go read the rest of it because they're patting themselves on the back, but it's interesting that Trinity Railway Express is already using it. And that's one step closer to a crewless engine, because now you got something that's going to detect stuff out there, and it's coming. It's just don't know. Got the PTC in place. You'll have the automated system that watches what's in front. Don't need a crew.
All right.
As opposed to now for a proposing point of view.
No, I have a question. Now, apparently you say Trinity's using it.
Yep. They're so far the only ones.
They're the only ones, and they're still testing it, right?
Right.
Okay. Now, what if you come to a city like Chicago or even Philadelphia, New York?
New York.
Well, they like to hang things in front of tunnels. Would it detect?
Probably. I can't say for sure because I've seen the demos of this on YouTube. They actually have a video up showing this. You can actually log into their website and see a live demo of this software in operation. But I don't. It does detect birds flying by, which I thought was kind of neat.
Okay. Well, you told me that. That eases my mind.
Yeah.
I think somebody should be in the cab because even, I don't know if you saw that video from a couple of days ago, the police trying to pull over a driverless car and they kept pulling away from them. So there's still problems. It can be done. But the question is, should it be done in urban areas? I still think that the first railroads are going to use it somewhere between the Mississippi and the Rockies because it's open, not very populated, and if something goes wrong, not a big impact.
Well,
so that means the first one we're going to see is between Washington and New York.
Well, we've had autonomous railroads here in this country. Muskego.
Yep.
Black Mesa and Lake Powell.
Oh, the airport. It's got the automated goofy train.
Well, yeah, Robert.
The goofy train.
Yeah.
Anyway, so
you had to get them started.
Yeah. Two more things. There's a group here in Chicago who wants to turn the old Kenwood L line that ran from basically about the stockyards to the lakefront into a rail trail. And they're pushing to get money to start the process.
Good for them.
They're going to have to recreate some of the bridges. Because some of the bridges
are gone. Yeah,
are gone.
Yeah.
There's buttresses on either side, but
rail trail bridge is certainly not at the same tolerances as a railroad bridge.
And the last item I have is one of these ones that has a very unfortunate name. Back in about 2004 or 5, a new transit agency called Space Coast Area Transit in Brevard County, Florida, is the transit agency that runs the buses down there to and from Cape Canaveral and up and down the coast. Think of the initials, SCAT. Well, I think somebody finally figured out what that really meant because as of the first of the year, they're now rebranding themselves, get the new name, 321 Transit.
This is Florida, huh?
Yes,
this is
Florida.
That is the area code for the Cape Canaveral section of Florida.
Well, and according to their website, they picked 321 because it says, the space, the takeoff for the rockets, 321. That's what they say on their website.
That is why the area code 321 was assigned to that section of Florida. They can say whatever they want to say. They've learned that well from the politicians.
They got a nice website, by the way, but
oh, hey, if it's on the internet, it has to be true.
321transit.org.
Really?
It's just that, it went like from 2004 to now with those initials, and I think finally somebody saw, wait a minute.
You're talking about the mine tailings and stuff. There's another interesting mine railroad story about the North Creek and Saratoga rail line.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, North, it was one.
I know where two locomotives are from it.
Really?
Yes. North Judson.
A couple who previously owned a nearby dude ranch. I thought it was a nude ranch.
you wish.
I think they did own a nude ranch somewhere. Wanted to ship military grade titanium ore from an old mine in the area, won an auction Thursday for the 30-mile stretch of railroad track between North Creek in the old mining community of Tahawas?
Mm-hmm.
Tahawas?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Excellent source. Well, it turns out that these people kind of blew it and didn't come up with the money in advance of the
when it was due for the bid, so now it's sort of up in the air whether anything's going to happen. The tracks are currently dormant and were auctioned as part of the proceedings of the San Luis and Rio Grande Railroad and its subsidiary, the Saratoga and North Creek. Now, was that owned by the...
Iowa Pacific.
Iowa Pacific, yeah, figures. Which several years ago tried and failed to run a tourist and ski train from Saratoga Springs to North Creek, which is near the Gore Mountain.
And they complained about everything. Where are they going to park? Oh, we don't want them here because they make too much noise at night. The houses were 10 miles away, but they made too much noise at night.
Well, that's New York. In January, Revolution Rail put in a so-called stalking horse or starting bid of $700,000 for the track. The bankruptcy judge said they would look at any other bids above $750,000 during the auction. Revolutionary Rail has for several years operated a summer rail card excursion service in which tourists can pedal along several miles of track in special carts. The route near North Creek follows a scenic stretch of the Hudson River. McLean Wright said they would likely try and work with Revolutionary Rail to keep the tourism attraction going. So that's all up in the air whether that's ever going to happen. Yep, I still say it was a nude ranch.
It works for me. Well, if you've been keeping up with stuff, there are now six services.
Yeah, six branches.
Six branches, and now in the Department of Defense. We got our big four. Coast Guard was added in. And we now have the U.S. Space Force. It is official. They are a real department of the Department of Defense.
Are they looking for space cadets? Because I qualify.
Oh, yeah, we got a few. And the thing is, I sat here and I looked at its symbol. And who designed this?
Somebody who plagiarized from Gene Roddenberry.
Bingo. He was a Trekkie.
Yep.
See? I say it was a Trekkie. My wife looked at me like, oh, you're crazy. I'm going, duh.
That'd be from the original, not from the later series.
Yeah. Yeah, it wasn't slimmed down. This is the original. I'm sitting there going, oh, my God.
HLM runs this, all of the series every day.
Yeah, well, they get, you know, and I'm going to order this car. I've ordered this car because I got the Air Force one that they originally painted in this scheme, which I have an extra one, which I'm giving to you to send to your niece. We're gonna make a rail fan out of her one way or another.
Have you seen the uniform jacket for Space Force?
Yes.
Oh my God! It looks like something out of Star Trek: Next Generation.
Uh-huh. I mean, it's.
Am I being overly sarcastic, Brian?
You're spot on.
But which ones are red? Because that's the guys you want to stay away from.
Yeah. Right.
The only...
They don't have a name, crewman number, whatever.
The only thing they did...
Number six.
The only thing they did right was they kept the traditional Air Force blue.
Oh, yeah. They're saying, you know, never mind that, you know, the astronauts were from all the services. Air wings.
You know what they say.
And they, you know, they're keeping the same fatigues, except if you're in Space Force,
they'll make yours.
All the embroidery is going to be in, you know, I don't know which is which. One brand, the Air Force and Space Force. One has the dark blue embroidery for U.S. Air Force and the name. The other has a base coat brown for U.S. Space Force and the name.
brown?
Yeah, like an earth tone?
When they do something in their pants when they take off?
No, I'm not going there.
No, when they're hiding on the moon.
Ah! Not going there.
They're camo.
But, you know, they had to do something so that they could wear a fatigue uniform and not be confused with the Air Force.
Well, I don't know. Space Force is in space. Air Force is in the air.
Air.
Although Space Force does have to travel through the air to get the space.
So. Yeah, that's right. That's right.
It's confusing.
Yeah, this goes all the way back to James Bond and Moonraker with that company of Space Marines.
Space Marines.
Well, I mean, what do you call a bunch of jarheads in pressure suits and armed with laser rifles? Jarheads with neat toys. But I mean, this is not a new idea.
No. It's been thrown around a lot.
It's been kicked around since Tom Corbett's Space Cadet.
All right.
Oh,
now we're talking.
Yeah.
Yeah, I listened to the Rocket Rangers.
Whatever happened to that spoof TV show that was on recently with the Space Force?
Oh, yeah. The one with the guy that does the voices.
Seth something or other.
Yeah.
It changed.
It went to one of those pay-per-view channels.
It went to a different network, and then COVID hit, and they're trying real hard to get it up and running again.
Yeah, they had the guy from the office was the
Orwell.
Star.
Yeah.
The Orwell.
Not that one. There was one that was like a contemporary.
Oh, it's on Netflix.
Oh, is it on Netflix?
You talking
Netflix.
About Resident Alien?
No.
That's on Sci-Fi Channel.
No, he's talking about the one with Steve Carell.
Steve Carell, right.
That is Space Force.
Is that what it's called?
Yeah. To refer to it as Tripe would be to defame Tripe.
Oh, it's a funny show.
It is.
It's garbage.
It's hilarious.
Steve Carell's great.
It's funny, so it's
any man who
he's
puts
so
in...
incompetent.
Well, see, that's just it. Any man who puts himself through the torture of getting his chest waxed to make a movie has my vote for getting an Academy Award, because he couldn't fake that if he tried.
Yeah, well.
But back
to railroading.
Yeah. Surface Transportation Board sets hearings to address rail service complaints. Oh, yeah. Put these back on.
Put your eyes back on.
Yeah. Surface Transportation Board yesterday announced it will hold public hearings April 26th and 27th on the recent rail service problems and recovery efforts involving several Class 1s. The board will direct operating and human resource executives of the Burlington Northern Santa Fe, CSX, Norfolk Southern, and Union Pacific to appear at the hearings. STB officials said in a press release, the board will also invite executives from CN, Kansas City Southern, and Canadian Pacific to attend. Other railroads, rail customers, labor unions, and other interested parties are interested to report on the recent service issues, they said. The board's action follows recent letters the board received from the National Grain and Feed Association, the Transportation Division of the International Association of Sheet Metal, Air, Rail, and Transportation Workers, and the public officials who reported problems of rail service, rail worker shortages, and or employee working conditions. Given the serious nature of these issues, reported the board, the board wants information provided at the hearing to inform potential board actions on those problems. Over the past 6 years, Class 1s have collectively cut their workforce by 29%, or about 45,000 employees. as part of the efforts to lower their operating ratios to satisfy shareholders, noted STB Chairman Martin Oberman. In my view, all this has directly contributed to where we are today. Rail users are experiencing serious deteriorations of rail service on too many parts of their networks. Railroads simply do not have sufficient number of employees. At the hearing, the board expects railroads to explain the actions they'll take to fix the problems. Geez, do you think recalling the workers might be one of them?
No, just working the ones they have harder to death.
Yeah.
UP announced that they're limiting shipments.
Yes.
They're actually putting a freeze on new shipments for a while.
That is correct, and that is all there is on that.
And the trucking industry is...
laughing.
Celebrations.
Yep.
Smiling.
Yep.
Popping up the corks.
Because they're going to get the waivers, and so they can operate triple trailers now anywhere.
Yeah, that's right.
Some restrictions on it.
God help us.
Road train.
Yep. Hey, they're taking their cue from Australia.
And some of the trucks in Nevada operate without a trucker in it. The robotic trucks.
I thought maybe they were hiring simians or something.
Same difference.
Paid to have a union.
Well, we know it. We've seen it. The Reading and Northern has returned steam locomotives to service.
Yeah, you've seen it on our Facebook page.
That's right. Reading and Northern last week announced its plans to use the T1 steam locomotive for 4 Iron Horse Rambles excursions later this year. If you've gotten Trains Magazine or Rail Pace, you would have seen the 2-page spread of them advertising the fall trips and such. The packet, the engine had been shut down since the late 90s, and it's been totally rebuilt. It's got its freight hooter on it, and she sounds pretty. And she ain't wobbling coming down the tracks. But most of the runs go from Reading station that they build just outside of downtown Reading. And they go through Port Clinton, which is where the headquarters is, to Jim Thorpe. And they got a couple trips going up to Scranton and Wilkes-Barre.
Didn't they have some kind of problems at Jim Thorpe with
the community
didn't want them there?
Yeah, and what it was, a couple of the townspeople that were on the board, they wanted to the railroad to pay like triple the money that they were paying the town to use the station and such like that. They were imposing an entertainment tax on them.
They didn't consider that people might get off at the station and purchase things?
Oh, that was bought up. Well, we're not worried about that. But yeah, that's what caused wanted more money.
You said the T1 wasn't wobbling. Was that a problem with the T1 or a problem with the track?
When you look at an engine, usually you see it going back and forth a little bit. Well, that's what I meant. And she was coming down nice and straight. Like she had new straight rail.
I was on the YouTube the other day, you know, looking for train stuff. And I found that there are at least 5 World War II, German Krieglocks, German decapod trains, steamers still in use. In Tuzla, I believe it's in Bosnia, or maybe Slovenia, and they've got 5 that are in primary use. And 3 that they're stripping parts off of. But these things are working every day. They were designed to work for 10 years. And, you know, 70-plus years after they were built, they're still pulling heavy freight every day.
You know, if they did that with several of the locomotives here, yeah, they would still be running.
It's just, you know, it's a decapod. It's not a small engine.
Well, the Northern's not a small engine either. The 484 is not a small engine. Now, it has 70-inch drivers, but they can go.
I was just amazed that it's still in service, still working hard every day.
You'd be surprised how many reserved engines are running that are steam. In Europe, hell, even England alone puts us to shame.
Yeah, I think England trotted out one or two major rebuild engines last year. I seem to remember you talking about it.
They made brand new engines because they didn't save the class. The Tornado, brand new engine, 2008 is when they launched it. Took 20 years to build. Getting all the parts and slowly making. And they got it rebuilt. And it was christened by Prince Charles, pulling the royal carriages. Between that engine and the Flying Scotsman, like I said, narrow gauge alone, they got more narrow gauge engines running than we got running in the East.
Is it my imagination or is Jack Benny playing in the background?
I'm listening to that, too.
A little bleed over from the control room.
Well, I would say so.
Is that Jack Benny?
I don't know. I don't hear it.
Okay, maybe that fall on my head was worse than I thought.
Did you hear something?
Yeah. We're both listening to Jack Benny.
Did you get a new filling in a molar?
That could be it.
I just think it's those microphones, because last time there was some kind of sound coming in on that one in the background.
Mm. Well, I fixed all that.
Okay. What else you got?
Well, let's see. 1309 did a beautiful break-in run, and and is now the largest largest ballet running in the United States. 2662. And I see people are still writing stories about the Allegheny being the largest steam locomotive built. I know, they just don't count the foot.
Why are they saying it's the biggest? Bigger drivers or bigger boiler or what?
Oh, yeah, it's the largest steam locomotive built, and it's not. The big boy does have it beat. We can start with the number of drivers and go from there.
It could be East Coast, West Coast. The East Coast just can't deal with the idea that the West Coast might have something better.
No, that's the way it's written up at the Henry Ford Museum.
Oh, well. Yeah, Henry Ford never made a mistake.
Which brings us next. There isn't going to be a new exhibit at the Volo Museum. They purchased one of the steam locomotives from the Henry Ford Museum. And it'll go on display in the summer. They're laying ninth length subtract. I saw two passenger cars that they got, and they painted one like a deep red. I looked at the car, and I'm going to go back and snoop around it, but it looks like it might be a Jim Crow car. Okay. If you look at the car, you got your passenger section, and you might have a baggage door, but then you'll have like three or four windows in front of it for other seats. And that was where they separated the black from the white. That's what a Jim Crow car is.
I understand.
No, no.
I was cringing because it's of what it represents.
Yes, but it's still part of history. And
They have a Jim Crow car at in one of the Smithsonian buildings.
There's a Jim Crow car at a museum in Campo. It was from Arkansas. And the coach that we got with it, it was used on movie trains. And we had it donated to the museum. And some cabinet makers came in and said, we'll rebuild this car as long as you get us the wood. Okay. And they did a beautiful job. It has traveled and been up to the Sacramento Museum.
There is a documented story of from the history of the Tuskegee Airmen, where a group of officers, black pilots, were traveling by train, and the conductor moved them out of the coach seats that they had back to the Jim Crow car so that German prisoner officers could have their seats.
Correct.
It wasn't right, but, you know, it's history.
Yep. But, but what they're going to be doing is they're buying movie trains. The mock-ups that they've made for movies for train wrecks and stuff like that, they've gotten one of the locomotives from Wild Wild West that Will Smith made, and they're getting the locomotive that derailed and got laid on its side in the Lone Ranger.
And where are they putting this?
They're putting it, well, right now they're laying the track out in the parking lot.
Sorry, that was...
Yeah, they got about 100 feet laid out.
Well, can we talk about something pleasant real quick?
Yeah.
I thought that was pleasant.
More pleasant?
What?
May 14th and 15th, Railroad Days will be taking place at the historic Pullman Foundation at the Pullman National Monument, 11141 South Cottage Grove Avenue. There will be a Pullman rail car display up on the tracks of the Metro Station at 111th and Cottage, and tours of the area. The doors will open at 9 a.m. and remain open until 4 p.m. These will be different cars than the three that were brought in last year.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, and this is being sponsored by the Historic Pullman Foundation as opposed to the National Park Service.
That's what the information I was given says.
It is HPF because I know some people on the board there.
And if anybody wants to spend a nice day in the garden, the Model Railroad Garden will be opening on May 7th at the Chicago Botanic Gardens.
I thought you were going to jump ship the way you've been talking about the steam engine at Volo.
No, I'll look at it. I'm going to find it.
Not me.
Not me.
I cut that off.
Coming.
Need a Band-Aid?
We have a couple of April 24th events coming up, competing with each other. The Spring Railroad Swap Meet and Northern Indiana Railroad Movie Program will be taking place Sunday, April 24th at the American Legion Post 66 in Griffith, Indiana. And it's sponsored by the Black Hawk Railway Historical Society And it is not just another toy train show, I'll have you know.
Ooh.
Also, if you don't want to go south and you want to go north, you could go to the Chicago Railroad Memorabilia Show at the Holiday Inn in Elk Grove Village. Over 100 tables of vintage railroad items, including china, timetables, keys, locks, and more. Sunday, April 24th, Elk Grove Village. For more information, well, this is posted on our Facebook page, so you can get it there. Also, coming up in July, Day Out with Thomas at Illinois Railway Museum, July 9th through the 10th, and then again on July 16th. And if you don't want to go there, June the 9th coming up, sorry. June the 9th coming up is Franklin Park Fest. They don't call it the Railroad Fest anymore. It's a weekend, June 9th through the 12th. And they have free live entertainment, and they have a railroad day. Saturday, June 11th, 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. Walk on and view interiors. I'm not sure who's going to be there, what's being represented, but that's always interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if anybody's seen that Facebook page from the supposedly scrap dealers. There's these people, I don't know, they're scrap dealers, and they claim that they're scrapping every historic piece of railroad equipment in the United States. Yeah, it's supposedly, quote-unquote, comedy website. It's just scaring the poop out of a lot of people. You know, they had the locomotive that, what's-his-face made?
Oh, the Leviathan?
Yeah, the Leviathan.
That's what that story was. Okay.
Yeah. I first saw it, and I thought, oh, my God, what? And then so then I went and did a little more investigation, and I went to their website or their Facebook page. And every entry was, oh, we're scrapping these locomotives in England. We're scrapping these locomotives in America. We're going to this museum, and we're getting rid of all their surplus equipment and cutting it up on site. And it's like, so finally I saw somebody said, this site is a joke. It's a spoof. It's fake news.
And it is fake news.
Yeah, it is fake news.
And the fact checker said it was a squirrel.
But what's not fake news... Elgin got hit again.
Yeah.
What Fox the hell? Do they have a target on their back?
Fox Valley Trolley Museum. They had been vandalized previously. Kids broke into one of the barns, broke out windows on cars. This time it was car number 8, which I believe is a CTA car.
Yeah.
Single car. And they set a fire in the middle of the car and slashed the seats.
Yeah, they figure what? Between $6,000 and $10,000?
Yeah. Well, you know, they don't have any security out there of any kind, as far as I know. No cameras, nothing.
I thought they got cameras after.
I thought so, too, but I don't know, for the money they're asking for the repair of the cars, they might invest in some more cameras if they don't have any.
I'll tell you, yeah, I mean, I put in steel doors. I don't give a damn.
Yeah, I don't know if these cars are parked. They may have been parked outside, too, because the barn space is taken up by restorations.
They need a cinder dick with a double barrel shotgun loaded with rock salt.
Yeah, obviously there's a lot of teenagers out there with nothing better to do.
Yeah, they think it's a big joke.
Yeah. But that's kind of a problem that a lot of museums have, vandalism. Unless you have a secure yard with razor wire fence on fences around the place, you know, if you can walk in off the street.
So many places that think they have decent security, you know, an old fat guy like me can penetrate their security.
We send you in there.
You know something, Brian? You and I could make a fortune running a penetration team.
I don't know nothing. Remember, I'm a dumb sailor.
Yeah, okay.
Right.
The guy that tells you he doesn't know a darn thing.
Well, hey, people laugh at me when I tell them I see the green flash.
Are we done?
See, you're looking at me going, what?
No. That was a knowing smile. That wasn't a happy smile.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Cue the train.
It's time for the express coming into the station. We want to thank you for joining us on our journey through the wonderful world of trains. Chicago Junction is a production of the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network and can be listened to on the web at the www.windycityhometown.com, where you can listen to tonight's broadcast and all of our past episodes. You can also sample some of the other fine programs that are being offered. Until next month, when you journey to Chicago Junction, this is your announcer, Brian Blue, saying happy rails to you, and good night, Mr. Ryan, wherever you are.
You have been listening to Chicago Junction on the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network from the John DeVita Broadcast Center on Wednesday, April the 13th, the year 2022. Chicago Junction was produced and directed by John DeVita, and our special thanks to the executive producer of Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network, Mr. John Ciccanda. This broadcast was pre-recorded on Wednesday, April the 13th, the year 2022. Until next time, friends, please be safe and thanks for listening.